Welcome to the State of Humanism and the American Humanist Association 2017. Be proud. Be really proud. Look at the people around you and congratulate them and congratulate yourselves. And then pay close attention to your fellow AHA members, board of directors, and paid staff who are going to be sharing with you what they've been up to this year. We've been busy. This is hard talking so slowly. We've been busy. Thank you. Thank the person sitting next to you and the folks back home who didn't make it to the conference. I think you'll be renewed when you hear what AHA has been up to, because you, your membership, your financial support, and our growing numbers have made all of this possible. I think it's a safe bet that everyone in this room was devastated by the November election, not just because the results have been the very antithesis of humanism, but because of how and what it informs us about our fellow Americans. I naively thought that there were simply basic values that all Americans shared, or at least were expected to share. We've gotten more than a glimpse of the ugly underbelly of America. It put on a lot of weight while we weren't looking. I have, like many progressives, put on my share of Trump weight. I thought it was just me munching away on my big bag of chocolate-covered pretzels and pistachios from Costco. That is until Mother Jones published an article about how progressives are focusing on comfort food. It's what humans do when we are feeling stressed. Our cortisol levels rise with our anxiety, and we eat and store away that resulting fat for the hostile days ahead. It's amazing how science can explain these extra 15 pounds. I tell you this because after you listen to and absorb the next 90 minutes, you will be lighter. And I hope a slight smile may appear on your face again. Remember that there is a great awakening among not just progressives, but average Americans who thought many of these battles of reproductive choice, saving the whales, had been won. We knew racial equality was still in play. The day after the inauguration, I marched in Colorado Springs. It was the Women's March. Usually when I go to a march in Colorado Springs, there's somewhere between 15 and 200 people who show up. That day in Colorado Springs, there were over 10,000 people marching. In case you don't know, we're the home of Focus on the Family, the home of the International Bible Printing Association, and about 100 other religious nonprofits. But it was very rewarding to have these 10,000 people around me. They weren't all secular humanists. Some of them, maybe most of them in Colorado Springs, were believers. But they were marching for humanist causes and humanist values. We're winning. It just doesn't feel that way. At AHA, we are picking our pathway through this new America and making great strides. Membership is up. The Humanist Society is averaging an average. We're adding about 2 new celebrants a week. And these are high-quality people. These are not people who just decided on a whim to become a humanist celebrant because they could pick it up online. These are serious, substantial people joining our ranks. Our chapter numbers continue to grow, and these chapters are doing amazing things. You'll hear about some of them tomorrow. So be heartened. Yes, we have our work cut out for us, but each of us is up to the task. So settle into your seat and feel the glow in this room as we tell you what's going on with the AHA. Thank you.
Hi, humanists. I'm John Hooper. I'm the treasurer of the Board of Trustees of the American Humanist Association. I'd like to start off by going through the financials in detail, item by item. First slide, please. Just kidding. Just kidding. That was a treasurer joke, I'm sorry. The association entered 2016 with expenses exceeding income by approximately $14,000. Most budget items were on track. Income and expenses for the year each totaled about $2.4 million. In summary, overall spending in 2016 was comparable to 2015, when special items are taken out of the picture. Revenue in 2016 lagged somewhat due to fewer bequests coming in. Now, that's recorded as a financial negative, but from an existential point of view, that's a positive. There are more of us here this year. Okay. On Earth. Okay. For this year, through April 2017, the association had expenses totaling around $750,000 and income totaling $600,000. The deficit was due mainly to the move to the new building, the timing of income and expenses related to the annual conference, which you are currently sitting at, and to a major direct mail campaign, which should show significant returns later in the year. Most budget items are at or near expected amounts. One other item of interest, your AHA Board of Directors has established a finance committee. Included in the specific responsibility of the committee, among many others, are reviewing the financial aspects of major proposed transactions, new programs and services, and making actions and recommendations to the board, monitoring the fiscal performance of the association as a whole and of its major subsidiary organizations against approved budgets, long-term trends, and appropriate benchmarks. The members of the Finance Committee are Becky Hale, Sunil Panikath, Jason Torpy, and myself. Establishing such a committee provides another level of fiscal oversight of your association's resources. Thanks.
Hi there, everybody. So, if you're a regular attendee to these conferences coming year after year, you're used to hearing me get up and say how humanism with the American Humanist Association is stronger than ever. But one of these days, that's not going to be the case. You know, we're going to have setbacks that might lessen our capabilities and impact. We may see the energy of our movement diminish, or we might even reach the limits of our community's development. But you know what? That's not the case today. Today, we continue to hit new highs in members, in Facebook followers, chapters, chaplains, press activity, and more. And as you'll soon hear from various programs and adjunct leaders, you're going to get to see the real evidence of that and the kind of activities that are going on that make that possible. I'm going to take a couple minutes to explain the breadth of the AHA and what it accomplishes, and I'm going to do that with the use of a little bubble chart that I like that some of you might know about. So this bubble chart, which you probably can't see at all from there now that I look at it up there, but I can explain a little bit about it. The outer edge of blue on the right is all the coalitions we're involved with. Well, some of the coalitions, the main ones that we're involved with. Stop Torture Now, Coalition Against Religious Discrimination, Democracy Initiative Coalition, National Coalition for Public Education, International Humanist and Ethical Union, Respect for Marriage Coalition, Secular Coalition for America, LGBTQ Lobbyists, International Family Planning, International Religious Freedom Roundtable. There are more, but these are the ones that have a regular ongoing presence in Washington that we're taking part in. Then there's another wing there of the yellowish color there, that those are adjunct organizations. These represent the Humanist Institute and its programs of child education, online education, graduate programs, the LGBTQ Humanist Alliance, the Black Humanist Alliance, the Institute for Humanist Studies, the Military Association of Atheists and Free Thinkers, Humanist Crisis Relief Program that we partner with Foundation Beyond Belief, the International Darwin Day Foundation, the Feminist Humanist Alliance, the Humanist Foundation and its programs of related to chaplaincy and celebrant programs, the Humanist Society and its sub-programs related to chaplains and celebrants and humanist invocations, as well as the Center for Free Thought Equality, our 501c4 lobbying organization, and its political action committee, the Free Thought Equality Fund. I mean, each of these bubbles represent so much activity that it's hard to even get the crack the surface of what's going on. So then we go over to the pink side. These are the, I'll go to the center first, the blue, the publications that we produce. For many years, those of you who've really been involved with AHA for a long time know that the Humanist Magazine, our flagship publication, you know, has been synonymous with this organization's name. That's one bubble up there, the Humanist Magazine. We also have the Essays in the Philosophy of Humanism journal that we do jointly with the Institute for Humanist Studies. We have the Humanist.com, which is the only online publication of in the humanist movement specifically that's got online original content every day. There's also Free Mind, our membership newsletter, and the Humanist Press books, publishing books all the time. Then we move over to the programs of the AHA that are done in-house, you know, at our new offices, which you hear about later. The Apignani Humanist Legal Center and all of the legal work we're doing with several or to a dozen cases active at any given time. The Kochar Humanist Education Center with our education work reaching out with our Kids Without a God website to parenting, to the Ten Commitments work that we have that enable us to have an alternative to the Ten Commandments that is actually more universal. We have advertising outreach, our development operation, our humanist heritage program so that we remember and we can keep the stories of the individual humanists alive for generations to come. We have the press outreach that you'll hear about and how we're getting into the news in thousands of locations every year. The advocacy outreach with our lobbying, our State Department work, Capitol Hill, but not just Capitol Hill, grassroots as well. We also have the Essays in the Philosophy of Humanism journal that we do jointly with the Institute for Humanist Studies. We have the Humanist.com, which is the only online publication of in the humanist movement specifically that's got online original content every day. There's also Free Mind, our membership newsletter, and the Humanist Press books, publishing books all the time. Then we move over to the programs of the AHA that are done in-house, you know, at our new offices, which you hear about later. The Apignani Humanist Legal Center and all of the legal work we're doing with several or to a dozen cases active at any given time. The Kochar Humanist Education Center with our education work reaching out with our Kids Without a God website to parenting, to the Ten Commitments work that we have that enable us to have an alternative to the Ten Commandments that is actually more universal. We have advertising outreach, our development operation, our humanist heritage program so that we remember and we can keep the stories of the individual humanists alive for generations to come. We have the press outreach that you'll hear about and how we're getting into the news in thousands of locations every year. The advocacy outreach with our lobbying, our State Department work, Capitol Hill, but not just Capitol Hill, grassroots as well. This conference that we attend, and the leadership programs that are part of that are listed as well, as is our field operations with affiliates and chapters and regional events. Think of the 200 some odd chapters that are under that one bubble. I mean, there is so much activity going on with the AHA, and this program will give you a glimpse into that. So, thank you very much.
Hello, I'm Megan Hamilton. I am the events and social media coordinator for the American Humanist Association. Can you hear me? Okay. No? Is this better? Is that too loud? I feel like I'm yelling. Okay. Today, I will be reporting to you on our very robust communications department. Through our media outreach, the AHA represents a focal point for the voices and viewpoints of millions of Americans who identify as humanists, atheists, agnostics, and non-theists. We issue press releases on our breaking news from our organizations and public statements addressing timely issues as they relate to humanism. Over the last year, we've offered a humanist perspective on major current events such as President Trump's transgender bathroom executive order and the International Religious Freedom Order, and major protest marches that we participated in, like the Women's March on Washington and the People's Climate March. The AHA's legal and legislative work has been covered by numerous national and international media outlets. As a result of our ever-growing activities, an average of 15 major media outlets cover our work daily, including outlets like the New York Times, Washington Post, Fox News, The Hill, USA Today, NPR, and many others. Recently, Royce Beckhardt appeared on Fox News' Spirited Debate with Lauren Green, and Matthew Bulger argued for the Johnson Amendment, against the Johnson Amendment repeal, live on C-SPAN. Royce Beckhardt's articles in the Huffington Post and David Niossi's articles in Psychology Today really allow for AHA to convey humanism in a more nuanced as it applies to current issues. The media is increasingly looking to the AHA to provide humanist and non-theist perspective on issues like LGBT rights, reproductive freedom, science, religious freedom bills, social justice, and more. To ensure humanism's reach to younger audiences and to remain on the cutting edge of communication, we've worked to gain a greater following on social media by maintaining active pages on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Right now, the AHA has over 650,000 followers on Facebook, making us we are the largest non-theist group on Facebook in the United States. Popular campaigns like our Sounds Like Humanism campaign, where we feature quotes by prominent freethinkers, gain tens of thousands of likes and millions of views on our social media channels. Social media really allows us to highlight all the great work we do, from lobbying to our lawsuits to supporting local chapters to our social justice advocacy. In total, our social networks reach over 4 million people per week, and we're only growing. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Louis Granados. I run the Humanist Press operation that publishes ebooks, and we do some printed books as well. Several new books have come out over the last year. We just put out the ebook version of Herb Silverman's work, An Atheist Stranger in a Strange Religious Land. He's been writing articles for the Washington Post and other publications forever. And this is a selection of the best work that he did, and that's available right now. We put out a new fourth edition of Lyle Simpson's book, Why Was I Born? A Humanistic View of Life, which focuses heavily on some of the psychological aspects of humanism. And I think the favorite of a lot of us on staff is the Cartoon History of Humanism, which you've probably seen out there. Dale DeBacci did a series of pieces for thehumanist.com, and now they're all, I wouldn't say all, this is volume one. This only gets you up to about like the Renaissance, and we're anxiously awaiting volume two. We have more coming in the pipeline. We're gonna have a collection of the best articles that appeared in the first 40 years of The Humanist magazine, going back to 1928, the mimeograph version of The Humanist magazine. That'll be coming out later this year. Michael Werner, I don't know if he's here, but he's been working and working on a book called Humanism, What You Can Believe In If You Don't Believe In God. And I reviewed an earlier draft of that, and you're really gonna like that when that comes. I've always wanted us to put out a book on the Ten Commitments, okay, which is our answer to the Ten Commandments. And that book is in progress and will be happening, I hope, by the end of this year. It's going to be a resource guide for teachers to be able to teach this stuff in their classes. And then finally, the other thing I've wanted us for a long time to do, which is now almost there, and I hope it'll be this year, is a guide for humanist celebrants. It is a phenomenon growing much faster than anyone understands, and have a good book out there about who's doing what will be an excellent thing for us to have. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. I'm Jennifer Bardi. I'm the editor-in-chief of The Humanist Magazine and senior editor of thehumanist.com. Thank you for coming to this session. I think we all appreciate having the chance to tell you about our work. Roy said that the Humanist Magazine bubble was just one bubble, but I think it was a really big one. It looked like... just kidding. So I'm going to start talking today about thehumanist.com, which is our daily online news site. We publish a lot of stories from a humanist perspective on science and culture, politics, and so forth. Since we launched the site in 2014, we've published over 2,000 articles and 20 online issues of the magazine. For the first 5 months of this year, the site averaged 125,000 page views from 80,000 visitors per month. Outreach efforts to new readers are proving successful. For the first 5 months of 2017, the percentage of first-time visitors is up 9% compared to the same period last year. So far, a few of the most read stories of the year include Their Ship Didn't Come In by Fred Edwards and Mike Reed, which is about the Ark Encounter in Kentucky. It's become a kind of a boondoggle for the county that helped fund it. Another article that was very popular was called Dear White Progressives. It was written by Sincere Carabo, in which he writes, allyship is a process and not an identity. Now, some readers are, I would say, flummoxed by why we publish articles like this, while others seem to think that the AHA's commitment to social justice should supplant its longtime dedication to constitutional justice and church-state issues. And I just want to say it's all important, and we will continue to cover it all. Another top story was AHA Development Associate Meredith Thompson's Harmony versus Knowledge. New study suggests liberals avoid opposing views as much as conservatives, to which people commented, we didn't need a study to tell us that. One of our goals with AHA publications is to balance the good, the bad, and the ugly. So to expose the bad, excoriate the ugly, and celebrate the good. We aim to inform, entertain, and engage, not only to illuminate our common values and perspectives, but to explore where they diverge. This is what a productive discourse and healthy humanism is all about. And I just would like to make a point there that keep in mind, if you disagree with something in one of our publications with a perspective, it's not an official position of the AHA. B, you have a voice in a forum to comment on that through a letter to the editor or a comment on the website or give me a phone call. I'd love to talk about it. The magazine is in its 76th year, and I hope we've maintained its integrity and quality. I've had to devote quite a bit more time to the daily publishing, but I feel we're trying to work towards more synergy there between those two mediums. In print this past year, we've talked a lot about you-know-who, and I even momentarily considered an editorial policy change to drop the R in the president's last name and just refer to him as Tump. But that's the stuff of comedy, not journalism. Even though the lines seem to be blurring these days. So in addition to all the things wrought by the new administration, we've covered a wide range of science, technology, and human rights topics. And I also recruited an arts editor, Dan Moran. So look for some more literary and fine arts coverage. And I'll end with a teaser. The July-August issue will feature several articles dealing with sex, including the increasing use of technology and how it affects the future of sex and intimacy. And I've got a few cover mock-ups with me if anyone's interested. And if you fall on the more prudish side of the spectrum, talk to me and maybe we can have it mailed to you in a brown paper wrapper. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm David Niosi. I'm legal director of the Avignani Humanist Legal Center. And I'll just start by saying I will have a session tomorrow morning, and I'll be going into a lot more detail on some of the stuff that I'm talking about now, but I'll just briefly give you an update on what we've been up to for the last year or so. To put it lightly, we've been very busy at the Allegheny Humanist Legal Center. Unfortunately, that's because the wall of separation has been under attack and is under attack like never before. Many communities around the country just seem to think that there's absolutely nothing wrong with injecting religion and specifically Christianity into local government. And we're hearing about it all the time. We're getting contacted on a regular basis, just about daily, by people who have issues to talk with us about. We have about a dozen cases in suit now, all in federal courts right now. We have had cases in state court in the past, but right now all of our cases are in federal court. Several are in federal appellate courts, in the circuit courts, in the Fourth Circuit, the Fifth Circuit, and the Tenth Circuit. Most of our cases, however, are at the trial court level, at federal district courts. So we have cases in Colorado, South Carolina here, New Jersey, Maryland, North Carolina, Nevada, Missouri, and a couple cases in Florida as well. We also currently are petitioning for cert with the Supreme Court. In other words, we're asking the Supreme Court to hear one of our cases for the first time ever. This would be a first for the American Humanist Association to be going to the Supreme Court. And that may be happening in the not too distant future if our petition for cert is allowed. You'll be hearing more about that tomorrow. We're also doing a lot more. We tend to think of the Legal Center as the litigation arm, and we are, and we think about the cases we have in suit. But we have a lot of stuff that we do that does not involve actual litigation. As I said, people calling us for advice and looking for help with a little issue in a local community, something that doesn't rise to the level of a lawsuit, but something that we can help on. We send complaint letters all the time. We send emails to superintendents and mayors in local communities. These are very effective, and a lot of times they don't make a lot of news either, but we are helping people around the country with church-state issues and discrimination issues all the time. It's just a constant flow. And we're doing even more. We're also in the midst of forming a new group for humanist lawyers, the Humanist Legal Society, which we envision as being the counterpoint to the Federalist Society. If you're familiar with what the Federalist Society has done, it's basically been a wrecking ball to jurisprudence in this country for the last generation or so. Well, we are setting up what we hope will be an organization that will have branches in all the major law schools and major cities around the country for humanist lawyers to discuss and network and think about how we can inject humanist values into American jurisprudence more. So that's some of what we've been up to. Oh, and we've also got our cooperating lawyers list. I like to mention this because we're up to over 180 cooperating lawyers. And if there are any lawyers in the crowd who are interested in being part of our cooperating lawyers list, please contact me because we're always looking for more. So thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Rachel Berman, and I'm the Grassroots Program Coordinator for the American Humanist Association. As of May 2017, we have approximately 121 chapters and 91 affiliates for a total of 212 groups in the field network. We're still looking for local humanist groups in four states, okay? So if you are from one of these four states and you want to create a chapter or a group, come to me, okay? So New Hampshire, South Dakota, Vermont, and Wyoming. Taking applications now. I want to get all 50 states. In April, members of the Harvey LeBrun Chapter Grants Committee announced the 13 chapters who would be awarded grants from the American Humanist Association's Chapter Grant Fund. The Chapter Services Committee received 25 grant applications this year. Many of the grants were awarded to chapters that were interested in expanding the group's visibility through increased participating in community events such as parades or marches. Then the 2018 chapter grant cycle will open December 1st, 2017. Earlier this year, the American Humanist Association revised and re-released two new and exciting resources for local groups, a manual for effective tabling and a guide for parades. I spoke about that yesterday during my talk. The manuals are available online for free at AHA's website. The manual for effective tabling is a comprehensive manual, and it's broken down into three parts: before the event, during the event, and after the event. The manual includes best practices for tabling processes, and photos of both effective and ineffective tables. A guide for parades encourages local groups to participate in both local and national marches and parades. The guides include step-by-step instructions for creating a professional banner, as well as examples of banners and signs. There is also an illustrated checklist available online. The checklist includes all the materials and where to purchase them in order to have a successful event. Several months ago, a new promotional brochure was created to encourage existing local humanist, atheist, and free-thinking groups to connect with and become a chapter of the American Humanist Association. Highlighted in the brochure is a map with the locations of all the current AHA chapters and affiliates. The brochure is now included in all new member packets, distributed at all AHA exhibitor tables, as well as events in which AHA staffers are invited to speak. In an attempt to have more of a presence in the secular community, the AHA continues to table and participate in marches and at many regional and national events. In 2017 thus far, the AHA has tabled at the Creating Change Conference, Logical LA, and the American Ethical Union Assembly, which is happening this same weekend in Baltimore. The AHA has also participated in the March for Science in DC and the People's Climate March, and was a minor sponsor for both events. The AHA plans to table at the following conferences the rest of the year: at the Northeast Conference on Science and Skepticism, which is the end of this month in New York; the Secular Student Alliance Annual Conference, which is next month in Ohio; DragonCon, which is in September in Atlanta; and Skepticon. And if anyone out there is attending any of those or thinks of good ideas where you think it would be worthy for the AHA to table at or march, please come talk to me because I'm really interested in hearing your ideas. Thanks.
Hello, everyone. Let me just fix this real quick. Can everyone hear me okay? How about now? I have an extremely loud voice, so you may regret asking me to speak closer into the mic. Hello, everyone. My name is Matthew Bolger, and I am the Legislative Director for the American Humanist Association, working out of our sister organization, the Center for Free Thought Equality. Our role in Washington, D.C. is to be a leading advocate of secular governance and humanist values. As a lobbyist, the way I spend a lot of my time is meeting with government officials to discuss the humanist perspective on the policy issue of the day. That includes meeting directly with U.S. representatives and senators, as well as with the staff from those congressional offices and the offices of various executive agencies, such as the State Department and the Department of Education. As a result of these meetings this year, the AHA has either introduced or modified existing legislation, such as the Freedom of Religion Act, which prevents immigrants from being denied entry into the United States because of their religious beliefs or lack thereof, as well as the Frank Wolf International Religious Freedom Act, which is the first law that includes the term non-theist and states that the freedom of thought, conscience, and religion is understood to protect theistic and non-theistic beliefs, as well as the right not to profess or practice any religion. I should note also that this is, I believe, the first bill which has been partially introduced by a non-theistic organization which has actually become law, which is a significant achievement for us. Because of our hard work lobbying on behalf of this bill, the act also condemns specific targeting of non-theists, humanists, and atheists because of their beliefs, and attempts to forcibly compel non-believers or non-theists to recant their beliefs or convert. We also recently worked to introduce a resolution which calls for the repeal of blasphemy laws worldwide. This resolution, H. Res. 349, encourages the President and the State Department to make the worldwide repeal of blasphemy laws a priority, while also opposing any attempts at the UN to support blasphemy laws. Of course, the AHA also works on other bills that don't focus on international religious freedom issues, which I'll talk more about in a minute, such as the Darwin Day Resolution, which affirms the validity of the theory of evolution and the threat posed by climate change, while also opposing the teaching of creationism in public schools, as well as the National Day of Reason resolution, which opposes the unconstitutional National Day of Prayer. The AHA also participates in several coalitions that work to ensure the church-state separation is the law of the land, and that the implementation of humanist values in public policy continue, including the organizations that Roy mentioned, which I won't go into right now. Two important programs under the AHA, as I just mentioned, include the National Day of Reason and Darwin Day. The AHA was instrumental in helping U.S. Representative Ted Lieu introduce a resolution, H. Res. 263, recognizing the National Day of Reason on the House floor. This is the first time that Representative Lieu introduced the National Day of Reason resolution, as the previous sponsor, the great Representative Mike Honda of California, is no longer serving in Congress. Co-sponsors of this resolution include humanistic Jew Representative Jamie Raskin, Delegate Eleanor Holmes Norton, and Zoe Lofgren. This year's Darwin Day was also a major success, as people across America and the world celebrated the contributions of Charles Darwin and science in general to the human race. The AHA worked with Representative Jim Himes of Connecticut to introduce the Darwin Day resolution, H. Res. 44, which would designate February 12th as Darwin Day and demonstrate legislators' support for science, reason, and critical thinking, while opposing, as I mentioned previously, the teaching of creationism in public schools. This resolution has 19 co-sponsors. Going forward, the American Humanist Association remains committed to raising the visibility of humanists through its persistent advocacy at the federal, state, and international levels. Thank you all.
Hello again. Can y'all hear me? I feel like this is like the reoccurring theme. Am I eating it enough? Ooh, that's really loud. Good afternoon, evening. I think we're officially into evening now. My name is Diane Burkholder. I am chair of the LGBTQ Humanist Alliance. It's my second year serving in that role. As you all know, Sincere Carrabo has been the social justice coordinator for about a year and a half and has been looking at ways to expand and really make sure that the LGBTQ Humanist Alliance is, in fact, intersectional, looking at many different things we need to fight beyond marriage equality and bathroom bills, which are very important issues, but there's a lot more issues facing the queer community. So one of the things we're going to be working on is a resource guide, and I realized this when I was on the panel earlier that I said queer and didn't define it, and a lot of people think that's a slur. It is actually a term that's been reclaimed by folks to talk about LGBTQ as the umbrella for basically anyone who doesn't identify as heterosexual or cisgender. So we're going to be creating a guidebook so you all know like what this all this alphabet soup is and these changing terms and what does this mean. And also another thing is we're going to be doing an overhaul of, you probably have seen it out on the table if you've been familiar and around with the organization, of the brochure, to make sure it's more inclusive of our needs, that it's, Regine did the talk about white saviorism. I don't know what this has to do with LGBTQ folk. It's a white woman holding a black woman. We need to make sure that like the stuff we're putting out there is representative of our communities. So the board is going to be looking at ways to review this, making sure that folks that are representative of the community, they're on the board, they're part of this association, are included in our literature, that are outward-facing information. And then the other piece is that to tying it to organizations to get us more visibility in the LGBTQ community, such as the National LGBTQ Task Force, the Secular Student Alliance, Foundation from Belief, that you all, Beyond Belief, that you heard from earlier, but also a lot of grassroots LGBTQ organizations that aren't the hallmarks of the LGBTQ community, that are often very white, very cisgender, very male-centered. What are the ways that we can support the grassroots organizers that have been doing this work? And then the last piece, particularly we've been working on, is the major LGBTQ conference that happens every year. This year it was in Philadelphia. At the same time, I believe this is the Women's March, right? I believe it was the same weekend. Sincere has joined the programming committee because much of the programming that happens there is very faith-based, which is a needed conversation in the LGBTQ community, but there needs to be many more voices of non-religious folk. And a couple of the panels that I went to, only non-religious people went there. So we need to have true interfaith dialogue about religious and non-religious folk, and also to create space for many more speakers and workshops to be engaged beyond that conference, but also in our communities and the other ways that this organization is engaged throughout the nation. So that's it for now. Till next year. Thank you.
Mijikchu Miwok. My name is Desiree Kane. I am a member of the Feminist Humanist Alliance here with the American Humanist Association, and I'm happy to update you all on what we have been up to. Last year, one of the things that was prioritized by the Feminist Humanist Alliance meeting was to join a collaborative campaign with NARAL Pro-Choice America based on reproductive rights advocacy, because that is something that affects everyone, including Native women like myself, women of color. There are a whole spectrum of women and femmes that this will serve. The AHA is also in the final stages, as Diane mentioned, of working on a resource booklet to basically provide a basic analysis, both for the association and for others, on the relationship between feminism and humanism. I really look forward to seeing this because I see something that is really needed in our communities. And indigenous feminism is something that has existed since the oppression of women began. And so I really look forward to seeing resources that are able to articulate this to the broader community that show humanists to the rest of the world of feminists like what we're about. Now, this room has a certain demographic, but I assure you that feminism is something that is much more broadly reaching than just the people in this room, as you know. You know, there are women and femmes everywhere. So I think that this is going to be very, very important. It will encourage the work with the National LGBT Task Force, the Secular Student Alliance, and the Foundation Beyond Belief. So those are platforms that are going to be really, really helpful to get this out there. And finally, I've been asked to share a brief personal testimony regarding the FHA project, but instead I'm going to uplift Sincere. So this is my second year with the FHA and the AHA in general. I think the thing that the AHA has been smartest in doing is to hire Sincere. I saw him at the No Dapple protest up in North Dakota, of all places. Here's this guy, my association, you know? But it can't always just be Sincere out there and us up here. We need you all. So I wanted to take that time to just say thank you to the AHA and to Sincere and to Roy for enabling Sincere. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ashton P. Woods. I hail here from Houston, Texas. I'm a co-chair for the Black Humanist Alliance, and I'd like to start by saying thank you to the AHA for choosing me to be part of such of a special project. Also, Sincere Carrabba. The Black Humanist Alliance was formed to do the obvious things and be inclusive of Blackness, specifically by being the Black Humanist Alliance, and to address racial disparity, the recidivism, incarceration, the usual kickback that we talk about. But what has happened over the last year or so is something more special. In my position as the co-founder of Black Lives Matter Houston, and I'm also a member of the LGBTQ community, I've been able to use my position to enforce atheism on non-believers, non-theism, on political platforms and actually in the grassroots level, so that when we have protests, I use that positionality to say, listen, are we erasing people by saying, let's get into a prayer circle? It looks like going to the state convention before I go to the DNC and help to, at points, lead the charge for the Texas Democratic Party to adopt a secular platform, which they actually did. So, at the end of the day, we all need each other. We have issues that we need to work out. But I'm appreciative of the fact that I'm able to use my platform with the American Humanist Association through the Black Humanist Alliance to continue to push change in Texas. Because I live in the biggest belt loop in the Bible Belt, the big, great state of Texas. And what I've learned by doing this work with the Black Humanist Alliance is that the people are actually open-minded. I've been working with clergy, bringing in humanist literature, and now churches are more open. They're showing up, they're being more intersectional, and I think that if we all continue to do this work outside of the Black Humanist Alliance as well, that people will be more receptive to atheists, and they won't look at us like we are the bad cousin who sits off in the corner doing a family reunion. So I'd like to close by saying we have a brochure outside. It won't be around for a while because we're working on a resource book. The resource book that's been mentioned several times is coming out. It's going to include information from each of our organizations. It's going to be an all-inclusive guide where you can look and see who to reach out to, when to reach out to them, and how to reach out to them. And that's something that we lack right now. Thank you for your time. My name is Ashton P. Woods. Black Lives Matter.
Good evening. My name is Debbie Allen, and I'm president of the board of directors of the Humanist Society. Humanists like to associate with like-minded people, not because we need to agree on everything or have our biases confirmed, but because there are moments in life when we just want to know and take comfort in the fact that we are not alone in our understanding of the universe and our place in it. A humanist celebrant plays a role similar to that of traditional clergy, with a significant difference. Humanist ceremonies express our positive, non-theistic philosophy of humanism instead of traditional faith. The Humanist Society is always interested in expanding our services to the humanist community. Best known for officiating at weddings, humanist celebrants also conduct baby namings, interreligious weddings, rites of passage, rituals around death, mourning, and celebrating a life well lived. We would also like to be more active in areas where religious people often have the benefit of chaplains, such as in prisons, hospitals, and the military. We are a working board, and this year, several of our board members are leading new initiatives. Kathy Dietrich, recently elected as board secretary, has organized quarterly conference calls for our celebrants. These interactive teleconferences offer practical information that celebrants can use to improve the ceremonies they provide and the celebrant businesses they run. The next teleconference is June 26th. Another activity we will be starting soon is the Mentor Advisor Program, led by our Vice President, Stephen Bechtel. If you are an experienced celebrant and wish to provide guidance to someone starting out, or if you would like to take advantage of a mentor, please leave your information at our table outside this room so that we can be in touch. And one of our newest board members and our treasurer, Joshua Berg, is working to expand our marketing promotional services to help spread the word about what we can do to those who prefer a secular or non-religious service and celebration. I would also like to mention our other board members, Kristen Wintermute, Jason Torpy, Arthur Jackson, and Becky Hale, who have contributed years of service to developing and enriching our celebrant program. And a note of thanks to Rachel Berman, our celebrant program coordinator, who keeps everything and all of us running smoothly. As of today, there are 328 endorsed humanist celebrants, chaplains, and lay leaders. Every year, we are growing in numbers, which allows us to more effectively serve those who desire our services. We have a table in the exhibit hall during the conference that is being staffed by Humanist Society board members and celebrants to answer your questions and to share the educational resources and support services the Humanist Society can offer. If you are interested in networking or chatting with other celebrants at dinner tonight, meet by the table with the yellow tablecloth between 6:30 and 6:45 and sit together to get to know one another. We hope that more of you will consider becoming involved in this very important and meaningful way of creating community for humanists. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Can everyone hear me? Okay, my name is Jennifer Kalmanson. I'm vice president of the American Humanist Association, but I'm also the president of the Institute for Humanist Studies. We have three major functions that we perform at the Institute for Humanist Studies, the first of which is managing several series of publications. The second is that we run an annual symposium out of which grow at least one of those publications. And the third function is advocacy and policy development. We aim to be the preeminent intersectional humanist think tank. So we're going through a phase of growth right now and a phase of development. So that means there are a lot of changes happening very fast. But on things that we've already begun, our Palgrave Macmillan book series is right along on track. Anthony Pinn, our executive research director, has begun a new reader-friendly book series with Pitchstone Publishing. And the first book in that series, When Colorblindness Isn't the Answer, Humanism and the Challenge of Race, has been released and it is being very well received. Our seventh symposium meeting took place last November. We're coming up on our eighth this fall. We are going to discuss the topic of public education with the filtering view of inequalities in our society, wealth inequality, racial inequality, etc. So looking at public education from a social justice filter. And that's where we're going with things. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Kristen Wintermute. I'm the executive director of the Humanist Institute. I almost forgot what I was doing. It's been a bittersweet year for the Humanist Institute, and I'll start with the sweet part. The sweet part is that we're continuing to add new and exciting programming. Our Humanist Studies Certificate Program, which is the foundation program most of you are familiar with, our graduate level program, has grown from a sequential three-year course of study for leaders to an open, flexible model of learning, enabling individuals to create their own educational path. We've added more stuff to our online COHE courses and resources to better serve the needs of our community. We've added a discussion guide that we can give out to local groups to help facilitate discussion on our self-guided courses. So you could take any individual self-guided course. Your leader can have this discussion guide to help facilitate like a book club. We've added contemporary topics. One of the contemporary topics which Diane might be, Burkholder might be interested in, is feminism and Desiree, Feminism and Humanism, Women of Color Beyond Faith by Sikivu Hutchinson. That's a new course we added this year. It's great, it's fabulous, you should read it. I highly recommend it. We're adding a course in August from Sharon Welsh of Meadville Lombard, a faculty member and current provost. She's writing a course for me on humanism and social transformation. And I'm hoping Phil Zuckerman will come through with a course on humanism and globalism. So we also this year started a new endeavor, which was something people kept asking me about. Why don't you have audio, video, online courses? So we started an open lecture series. And the first one we did was on the future of humanism at the First Unitarian Society in Minneapolis. And we videotaped that. That's currently online. It's a four-part series. It's free of charge. Go to cohe.humanistinstitute.org to see that. It was a great panelist speakers, Tony Pinn, William Hart from McAllister, I'm blanking on who else was there. Oh, Phil Zuckerman and Chris Stedman from Yale Humanist all served on a panel and spoke at this about the future of humanism. Sunday will be our seventh celebrant training. This has been a great success. We've done them in Florida, in Washington, at Rutgers University, Minneapolis, and today, Sunday, we'll do one in South Carolina. The biggest thing I'm proud of this year is our second open lecture series, which Ashton, Desiree, Diane, Sincere, and two other people. The two other people that participated in this was Bobby Champion, who is a Minnesota state legislator, and Andrea Jenkins, who is the first transgender woman running for Minneapolis City Council. They all came together two weekends ago. Who am I missing? Sakivu Hutchinson was there too. I'm sorry. We all came together two weekends ago and talked about social justice, and their message is extremely powerful and important and very challenging to my white privileged self. So I thank you for being there, and thank you, Sincere, for helping me organize this great panel of speakers. The last thing I'll talk about is we're doing a master class in August for established professional leaders. It'll be run by William Hart from McAllister. He's doing it on humanism and anti-blackness. So if you're interested in taking this course, it's invitation only. Just send me a little email or talk to me here at the conference, and I'll put you on the invitation list. It should be an excellent course. So that's all I have. Oh, the bitter part. I forgot the bitter part. Can I say the bitter part? Okay, I hope I can get through this without crying. The bitter part is this year. No, I can't. It's hard in this room, especially. We lost a quintessential contributor to the Humanist Institute. That was Carol Wintermute, my mom. She was in the first class of the Institute for over 30 years. She dedicated her wisdom and her knowledge to create a legacy. And I thought I'd get through this okay, so I'm really embarrassed now. But I just want to thank Carol for being my mom and raising me as a humanist and helping me be the person I am and creating the Institute and all that she did.
Woo, Carol!
Hi, I'm Ron Millar. I work for the Center for Free Thought. I'll eat the mic, okay. I work for the Center for Free Thought Equality, which Matt described as the advocacy arm of the American Humanist Association. Specifically, I run the political action committee called the Free Thought Equality Fund, PAC. Our mission is to help elect atheists and humanists to public office. Our goal is to help eliminate the negative stigma against our community, promote public policy based on evidence and reason, and obtain equal representation for our community in elected office. As of today, we have a grand total of 31 openly secular elected officials from all elected officials. But you need to keep in mind that's from a universe of 500,000 elected officials. We have some work to do. All right, now I have an interactive portion of my program. I'd like everyone who has voted in the last election to raise their hand. All right, good. But remember, elections don't happen once every 4 years. Participate in your municipal, state, local elections, because that impacts your day-to-day life more than you think, and because so few people vote, your vote will really be important in those elections. All right, raise your hand if you have either donated to or volunteered for a political campaign. Excellent, that's more than I thought. That's great. Okay, doing this, you make a friend for life, or at least a friend for that politician's political life. And importantly, because you're on their list when you go to meet with them, and you should always go to meet with them if they get elected, because you want to hold them accountable and increase our visibility as a community, you'll get in the door more likely if you made a donation, even a small donation, or volunteered for their campaigns. All right,
Who has attended a debate or a candidate forum? All right, that's very good too. This is a great opportunity when you take your colleagues and friends and wear buttons and t-shirts to increase the visibility of our community. Also, don't be afraid to ask questions and with your outfit on or identify yourself as a member of the community and talk about an issue that's important to us. Again, it's raising visibility, it's engaging in the political process. We have to do this. Also, consider about hosting or co-hosting a candidate forum. It's perfectly legal for nonprofits to do this. So again, visibility, building relationships, this is incredibly important. Okay, raise your hand if you've run for political office. Hey, cool, great. All right, thank you so much. In future years though, I wanna see more hands in the air because we've gotta take, this is all steps and you gotta participate in every step, so we need more people running for office. All right, last one, here's the tough one. Who is currently a sitting elected official? Howard Katz.
Yeah, Howard!
Earlier this year, he was our 31st person on our list because now he is township clerk in Illinois. So thank you for running, thank you for serving. And Howard's a great example because he's run a few other elections campaigns, and this is his first successful one, so don't give up. Again, it's about persistence, building networks. All right. So, the Free Thought Equality Fund has resources on our website to help you make your voice heard, how to engage your organization in the electoral arena, and how to run for office. So share them, use them. Who's gonna run in the next, before 18? Raise your hand. Excellent. So we definitely want to see more of those hands go up because you got time for 18. This is the perfect time to start planning for your 2018 or 19 or beyond election. All right, so go to our website at the Center for Free Thought Equality and become a member because that's the only way you can stay up to date with our activities because we only release who we endorse to our membership. And best of all, membership is free. And I don't bombard you with emails. I actually only email you when we're doing something. It's shocking for those of you who are on other lists. It's gonna be so refreshing for you. Okay, so to conclude, our democracy is diminished if the secular community, which is somewhere between a fifth and a fourth of the population, is effectively denied participating in public office. Whether it's denied because we don't run, because we don't feel comfortable, or we're denied because the outside pressures are gonna stop us from running. So participate, be engaged, run for office, support our candidates. Thank you.
My name is Jason Torpy. I'm the president of the Military Association of Atheists and Freethinkers. Before I get started, I'd like to recognize any active duty military. Did we get anybody here from the Charleston base? Anybody nearby? Okay, I think that's unfortunate. We'll work on it. Any veterans? We got veterans here. Round of applause. We don't have time now to do it justice, but later on, I'd like you to take time, 30 seconds, 5 minutes, time, to sit down with your thoughts and remember those who have served, who you know who have served in your family, and especially those who didn't make it back, to defend our values. Defend American values and hopefully those values that are consistent with humanist values and not American values that have been pushed by corporations or other non-humanist, non-humanitarian interests. I want to tell you a story just a few months ago to give you an understanding of the situation within the military that I'm working with the AHA to fix. A woman contacted me and said, I want to start a humanist group. I want to start a humanist group because our unit is going out for a deployment on a naval vessel. We're gonna be gone, we're gonna be away from home. These kids are dealing with this, with time, with putting their lives on the line, potentially. They're gonna be away, they need to attend to their values, they need to think about these ultimate questions in life, and we'd like your help to do that. I provided a retired Navy petty officer to help out immediately. Ian Dodd was nice enough to support as well from the AHA board to go up and talk to them about how to do this best. And this woman said, hey, I want to start this group. I want to really support other humanists here on this vessel so that they can have the same rights that everyone else have, that the Christians and the Buddhists and the Hindus and even the Wiccans, you know, all of these other communities that seem marginalized. But she wanted to start this humanist group. She suffered immediate coordinated senior officer opposition from evangelicals within her unit that had no interest whatsoever, that had a very strong interest in opposing this. And that's the situation throughout the military. And imagine all those who were discouraged just by the culture and won't even ask. And I want you to understand, this person was not a junior humanist person, you know, just a troop trying to get support. This person who was trying to help out and create this humanist community to support those who were looking for other support, this was a Christian chaplain working, doing her job the way it's supposed to be done. And this Christian chaplain suffered coordinated opposition from her Christian colleagues to oppose this. And she deserves a round of applause right here for trying to do this. We need to know that these friends are out there. We need to be ready for them, ready to step forward and help out. And I want to thank out all of those people with the AHA who have provided, you know, this mass that the military association does not itself have. Matt Bulger here, Rachel is helping out with the Humanist Society, you know, to coordinate those celebrants, provide that expertise. We've got Sincere providing staff support of all the communities in need that he supports. He also supports the military community on it, and I appreciate that. It's very much needed. Dave Niosi with the Legal Society as well. This is how we're going to be successful. And this is how we've been successful. If you have not heard, we had a major win just recently where the Department of Defense recognized humanism. All right, and what that does, this has been many years coming, and it is a very great victory, but it's a very tenuous victory. And we all need to be ready to leap forward as chaplains in the military and commanders in the military now have this recognition that it allows them to do the right thing. That gives them plausible deniability to say, well, you know, I know you're all these bigots within the command, all these people in power that have opposed us for so long. Hey, it says that we're recognized now, so it's okay for us to help and do the right thing. We need to have volunteers like Ian did. We need to have volunteers around the country to step forward, to be there in those local communities at Fort Jackson, at Parris Island, here in South Carolina, to help out at military basic training, because how we can be successful is how we've been successful where they've said yes at Air Force basic training. This Sunday, nearly 1,000 trainees will show up for humanist services as they do every weekend, as they have for years. And that's what success looks like. That's how we can be successful if all of you are available. You know, and militaryatheist.org has a spot. It says get involved locally. It has a spot for students. It has a spot for civilian groups. You know, and as that grows and becomes more robust, you all can make a difference in moving this forward through the Military Association, through the American Humanist Association, and through all those adjuncts, you know, including the Institute, which I didn't mention, which is doing a lot of work to ensure those chaplains have the right information to actually help us, not to just wing it. So this is what I hope you can do. This is how we've been successful, and it's not just the Military Association, it's the American Humanist Association, all we do, and all of you, as the body of humanism, to be there and to provide that support. And when that dam breaks, we can rush through and help out all of those troops who have for so long not had the help that they deserve.
Yes, I'm short. So I'm here to tell you on what's happening with the International Humanist and Ethical Union. The American Humanist Association is a member organization and one of the largest member organizations. Recently, and I am the representative to that as well as serving on the AHA board. Recently, IHU has become even more international because we have added people from various countries around the world that were not represented before on our board. We have 9 board members now, including one from Guatemala, someone from Nepal, and someone from Uganda in Africa. So we are definitely international. We also have a new chief executive who is Gary McClellan. He is from Scotland, and we have a development director who is from Italy. So we are extremely international. We're working on things like blasphemy laws. You heard about that earlier. We have representation as an NGO at the United Nations in Geneva, as well as in New York City. And we're fighting the blasphemy laws around the world that are in force in countries where if you blog about non-belief, you put your life in danger. And several people have been hacked to death. And we're fighting against that. So that's one of the things that we're doing. We fight for separation of church and state. And we're having our General Assembly this year in London. I hope some of you can be there. We were supposed to actually meet in Sao Paulo this year, but they couldn't quite get enough money. So we're not having a Congress this year. But in 2020, which is 3 years from now, the AHA is going to host the International Congress, and it will be in Miami, so mark your calendars. We have Maggie to thank for helping get that resolved, as well as, there's Maggie, take a bow, and Roy. So please do plan to attend there, and I'd like to say that this has been a wonderful opportunity for me to meet lots of people around the world, to travel. I've been on their executive board for 6 years now, and I am completing my term, and we are hoping that there's a person here who will be able to take my place, and we're having an election over there, so with any luck, Becky Hale will be my replacement. We're going to keep our fingers crossed that she will represent us. So, thank you very much.
Hello, I'm Herb Silverman, president of the Secular Coalition for America. Yay, Secular Coalition. The Secular Coalition is a political advocacy organization representing secular Americans in our nation's capital. Its mission is to increase the visibility of and respect for non-theistic viewpoints and to protect and strengthen the secular character of our government. The coalition has 18 member organizations, including the AHA, of course. All the organizations are good without God, though some emphasize good and others emphasize without God. But working in coalition, we put aside the 5% on which we might disagree, including labels, and cooperate on the 95% we have in common. The Secular Coalition lobbies Congress and the White House to defend secular principles and policy. So please go to secular.org and consider signing up for our action alerts, which lets you know about upcoming legislation and makes it easy to email your elected officials. The more frequently that members of Congress hear from our community, the more attention they will pay to issues important to us. You might additionally become part of our growing rapid response network, which consists of people willing to call, write, or see members of Congress in their home district. We also have state secular coalitions, with which I hope you will all become active. On the opening day of the Democratic National Convention in July, the Secular Coalition hosted a successful secular democratic reception for non-religious delegates and attendees, an opportunity for non-religious Democrats to learn how they can advocate for church-state separation, science-based policy, and visibility for atheists and humanists and their local Democratic parties. Over the past year, several state Democratic secular caucuses have formed, including in Arizona, Utah, and Texas. And thanks, Ashton, for your work on that. The Secular Coalition is nonpartisan, which is why we're looking for activists in every state to help organize secular caucuses, not only in the Democratic Party, but also in the Libertarian, Green, and Republican parties. Finally, we've increased the number of advocacy days, both nationally and in states. I'm looking forward to seeing some of you in D.C. next week at our annual lobby day, where we'll have an opportunity to meet with our representatives and discuss issues that are important to our constituency. Again, check secular.org for details and pick up one of our brochures at the back. The Secular Coalition for America is working on a better life for all of us. Now you'll hear from Fred Edwards, who believes we should have a better afterlife.
Thank you, Herb. All right, I'm Fred Edwards, and because of my 40 years of activism in the AHA at both the local and national levels, I've now become the AHA's historian. As such, I've been working with John Leaker of the Humanist Archive in the Meadville Lombard Library at the University of Chicago. That archive now professionally houses the AHA's 76 years of historic material, making it available for researchers. And I've become the conduit through which longtime activist humanist leaders, like Art Jackson sitting over there, have been able to secure the preservation of their personal humanist papers. In other words, I helped Art Jackson clean out his garage in San Jose, California. The rest of my time is spent as director of planned giving for the Humanist Foundation, which is the endowment fund of the American Humanist Association. I talk to humanists about how they can continue to support their values even after they're dead by remembering the AHA in their estate plans. The Humanist Foundation soundly invests the bequests it receives and then pays the earnings annually to the AHA in support of new programs. Thus, when you leave a legacy gift, it becomes a gift that keeps on giving. Recently, on May 20th, the trustees of the Humanist Foundation met in Washington, D.C. to conduct its business of overseeing the handling of those bequested assets. At that meeting, they approved the computerized dynamic asset allocation of AllianceBernstein, which is the global asset management firm that provides investment management and research services for the foundation. Over the past year, our stock assets did well, even after fees, compared to market indices. One issue I pressed at this meeting, which I've been hearing from bequest donors I've talked to around the country, is how we can ensure that our investments are socially responsible while at the same time not reducing returns on investment. So the trustees and the AllianceBernstein representatives looked at methods of selecting four investment positions which score favorably on environmental, social, and governance indicators, and filtering out positions which compare unfavorably or which directly violate humanist values in some other way. In other words, the Humanist Foundation seeks to engage in socially responsible investing while getting the best returns on the best money, bequest money, entrusted to their care. This will be delved into at greater detail at the next trustees meeting when the AllianceBernstein representatives come back with a more specific plan. So we see that it is the Humanist Foundation of the AHA that is largely responsible for funding the excitement and growth the AHA is now enjoying, even in these troubling times. You've heard the reports of the other speakers here. You know that humanism is on the rise. But behind the Humanist Foundation, there are all those optimistic and determined humanists who came before us, whose legacy I helped preserve through the Humanist Archive. They realized that the AHA would have to weather storms, storms that the regular fundraising process couldn't cover. So in their thoughtfulness and foresight, they left the AHA a bequest. Perhaps it was just 1%, or 5%, or 10% of their entire estates. And perhaps when they wrote their wills, They didn't have much in the way of assets, but they, as they said in Star Trek, lived long and prospered. And so their generosity grew as their wealth did. And when it reached across time, it advanced their humanist values, even when the struggle for those values grew difficult, as it is now. So we thank those humanists of the past who made the AHA's greatness possible. They allowed our endowment to grow to over $8 million. And tomorrow, future humanists will thank you who have remembered the AHA in your life insurance, will, trust, or other estate plan. But for those of you who haven't yet made a will, I have a special request. Perhaps maybe you believe you're just too young to die. So here's my special request. Please don't pass away before you write your will. Hang on there. Eat healthy. Travel safely on your way home. And as you do so, think of your genes, your loved ones. Think of your memes, your humanist values. Then take that special place you have in your heart for both, and put it into writing. If you have questions about all this, boy, do I have some information for you. And you can read it, and you can also give it to your tax accountant, your attorney, and they can use that to help you remember your values in your estate plan. There's no pressure here, really, because no salesperson will call. Just give yourself the opportunity to think about this. And if you do decide to remember your humanist values in your estate plans, I guarantee that future generations of humanists will be as thankful then as you are now for our great American Humanist Association.
We have a couple minutes for questions, but before we do that, I want to just tag on to what Fred said, because there's a really very interesting side effect to being an active member of the American Humanist Association. It extends your life. We're not quite sure how, but the people who are active in their humanist communities, especially the people who sign up to give money to the foundation, they keep living and living and living. So it's a wonderful side effect. Okay. Questions? Woody?
As I know, campaign finance law, political action committees are able to give money to candidates to support their election, but they need to get that money from people to then give to the candidates. And as I remember the law, you can give up to $5,000 per year to a political action committee. Would the Free Thought Equality PAC accept contributions from people up to $5,000 a year?
Stand up, Ron.
Nancy Bolt from Jefferson Humanist in Colorado. This is such a wonderful PowerPoint that begins to clarify the many arms. I'm wondering if you could make that available to chapters, if you could send it to us, because this might be a good thing to put on our individual websites to show all the different things that AHA does. And right now, would you put that bubble thing back up? I'd like to take a photo of it.
My question is for anybody who is working on constitutional law on the state level, in the state of Texas, it's technically illegal for me to run for office because the state constitution says that you have to believe in something in order to get on the ballot. So when are we going to get together and shut that down? That was my question.
Okay, we have a few other housekeeping items. The first thing is, really, is this staff and these volunteers, are they not rock stars? Let's give them a big hand. And they've been working under pressure.
Just a comment to the last question about the state constitution prohibiting atheists from running for public office. That was an issue in South Carolina, and after an eight-year battle in the state Supreme Court, we won, and now all states can have atheists or humanists run for public office. Some states might challenge it. Let them challenge, because there's enough law behind it that we follow the U.S. Constitution, not state constitutions, when it conflicts with the U.S. Constitution. Okay.